Fellow citizens, it has been 2 years since we took the oath of office. Following the overwhelming mandate, you, the good people of Borno State, entrusted in us during the 2019 democratic transition. In these 2 years we have together witnessed continued turbulence, even though in the midst of shared hope, shared optimism, shared faith, shared resilience and communal determination to physically devote ourselves to freeing our Borno from 12 years of vicious insurgency. As part of that commitment, we, from our first day in office, made security our number one priority. This is in recognition of the fact that the fundamental duty of any government is to ensure the safety of citizens to such a level that citizens themselves feel they are safe. My first activity as governor of Borno State was to interface with head of military involved in the fight against insurgents. In our first week in office, we interfaced with thousands of our volunteers from the civilian JTF, hunters and vigilantes, who increased their monthly allowance. In addition to allocating to them more patrol vehicles and other logistics needed to enhance their operational roles of complementing armed forces in fighting Boko Haram. In our combined approach, we took aggressive steps of recruiting thousands of hunters from different parts of northern Nigeria, mobilized and deployed them to accelerate our support for the military. We made it a policy that in all our 27 local government areas, volunteers were strengthened with additional recruitment, surveillance vehicles, and other gadgets. We extended tremendous support to the military, the Nigerian police force, and other armed forces through the allocation of vehicles, armored personnel carriers, and other logistics. We gave far-reaching support to families of fallen heroes, other security personnel, and volunteers. We made the government house 100% accessible to commanders of all armed forces in Borno, and ensure we give serious considerations to all security-based requests. On a regular basis, we held several high-level collaborative consultations with Mr. President, Commander-in-Chief, former and incumbent service chiefs, the Inspector General of Police, and commanders of all paramilitary organizations, the Director Generals of the DSS and the NIA, as well as heads of military and security agencies resident in Borno State, with several efforts on the fight against insurgents. I was at headquarters of the multinational joint task force in N'Djamena, and I even held a meeting with the president of Chad, as well as governors of provinces in Niger and Cameroon, all towards increased security collaboration. From our first week in office back in 2019, we began throughout all the 27 local government areas to identify their priority needs, and we interface with critical stakeholders in these local governments to select areas requiring immediate short and long-term interventions. Findings from these assessment visits to 27 local government areas provided the guide to the policies, programs and capital projects we have embarked upon from our first 100 days to our first year in office. In our second year, we have, with the full participation of all stakeholders, developed, launched and adopted a 25-year development plan for Borno with initial 10-year phase of implementation. We, however, recognize that no plan of ours could succeed when hundreds of thousands of fellow citizens, especially those displaced by insurgents, live with hunger and indignity. From day one, we were faced with acute humanitarian crisis, particularly in northern and some parts of central territorial zones. As such, we made it a policy that as a governor, I assumed the role of chief humanitarian officer for different reasons. On one hand, it was our duty to deliver help to our fellow citizens that were either internally displaced or taking refuge in neighboring countries. On the other hand, there was a risk that insurgents could, after making IDPs socially and economically vulnerable, also explore the vulnerability of offering food and cash incentives to recruit fighters who could even serve as their spies in communities. From records we have experienced, instances when insurgents offered as low as 5,000 and 10,000 naira to recruit some spies and smugglers of weapons. We therefore needed to take steps ahead by making sure we regularly visit IDPs in all parts of Borno State, including remote locations, to efficiently and sufficiently deliver food, cash support, and clothing. We needed to ensure that our citizens had the support they needed. They were not exposed to potential attractions for the incentives of insurgents. Fellow citizens, our socio-economic interventions did not stop with IDPs. For instance, we took measures to curtail and properly put an end to street begging. To achieve this, we began conditional cash support to physically challenged persons while working on empowering them with means to rely on themselves through vocational skills, particularly peculiar to the individual as and group conditions. We took a bolder step towards reforming the Almadi school system, which we call Sangaa here in Borno. Consequently, a bill to establish Sangaa in Islamia Board was sent to the State Assembly. Meanwhile, we have in our reforms banned political thuggery amongst our youths across the state. We have, with the full cooperation, combated the energies they use for political thuggery into productive uses that improve our environment while we pay their monthly stipends for livelihoods. Government will soon come up with more funds to support these youths. Fellow citizens, in our social protection and economic drive, we took far-reaching steps to stimulate businesses and local economies by giving start-off capital to small entrepreneurs and increasing the investment of medium-scale entrepreneurs in major towns of our three senatorial zones. Recognizing the critical importance of the local government system, we organized elections to put in place democratic leadership. In doing so, we raised the bar of leadership by encouraging university professors and their likes to aspire to become chairmen so they could mix with our experienced grassroots politicians in order to stimulate comparative and competitive progress. We also encourage and even compelled royal fathers to remain in their domains because their presence inspires public confidence and resilience. We undertook several impromptu visits to local government areas in order to instill discipline in our civil and public service system at the grassroots. During these visits, we applied the reward and sanctions to ensure our hospitals had doctors, nurses and other medical staff, our schools had teachers and school administrators, and our royal fathers were gloriously on ground to inspire all of us. In our supervisory approach, we made it a habit of showing up at late night, early mornings, or at any odd time to hospitals, schools, IDP camps, water service areas, ministries and other government establishments. I even established an office annexed at the Musa Usman Workers Secretariat in order to keep civil servants, particularly those at the top levels, on their toes. I made my appearance to the secretariat continually and predictably to even my security and other personal aides. Our approach has steadily yielded dividends, as we can see from gradual pickup of increased commitment in hospitals, schools, other government institutions, and in our local government areas. We shared commitments, and with the growing goodwill, support, and prayers from you, the people of Borno State, we are delivering 556 capital projects, with 70% of total already completed, while 30% are at various completion levels. projects done with your support include 194 capital projects on education, which encompasses rehabilitation, completion and fresh construction of medium-sized government technical colleges, primary schools in different communities. We have 63 capital projects on governance, and another 63 capital projects on roads, transport, rural and urban development. 59 capital projects are being delivered on water and environment, while on health, we are delivering 58 capital projects that include establishment of 74 primary health care centers across local government areas. Rehabilitation of 8 general and specialist hospitals in MMC, Biu, Dombo, Momuno, and Mabuleni. We have undertaken 53 capital projects on reconstruction, rehabilitation, and resettlement, which involves expert combining over 6,000 resettlement houses for IDPs and refugees in 15 towns. I'm happy to once again acknowledge that His Excellency Mr. President Muhammad Buhari has since approved 10,000 resettlement houses in Borno State. I'm also happy to note substantial number of these houses have been completed with more ongoing. There are 28 capital projects on jobs creation, youth empowerment, and humanitarian support, which includes an all-inclusive vocational training center with 14 workshops for capacity development of 1,500 persons per annum. I'm happy to recall that with your support, we have worked towards the academic take-up of the State University, which was established in 2016. The Senate has since been inaugurated, with students enrolled and academic activities ongoing. We have continued all projects made on the ground and started newer infrastructures. We have even commenced the construction of teaching hospital and a medical college to prepare the university for the award of degrees in medicine and other medical programs. We have successfully lobbied for the approval and take-up of a federal polytechnic in Borno State, and hopefully we will soon have a federal college of education. Hitherto, Borno has remained one of the few states in Nigeria which had no federal polytechnic and college of education. Fellow citizens, as your governor, I'm however aware that in the midst of all that, what we have been able to achieve, there are indeed concerns about some of our policies and actions in the last 2 years. Top of these are issues relating to taxes of kekenape, on commercial goods in markets, on shops, on consumption and entertainment, and other issues. I'm also aware of issues related to ongoing reforms in land administration by the Borno State Geographic Information System, BOGIS, which deals with and also imposes some aspects of urban planning and environmental rampant roadside trading. These concerns and many others I did not list are largely genuine, and citizens have fundamental rights to be worried and to even be unhappy with these policies. Fellow citizens of all Nigerians that 60, none is faced with the level of Borno security and by extension, social and economic challenges. Borno has thousands of volunteers who have been paid monthly allowances, provided with kits and vehicles to complement the military in the fight against Boko Haram. Fellow citizens, for every unfortunate incident of attack that occurs, more attacks will have been prevented through combined efforts that cost money. Also related to security, we continually support IDPs and vulnerable citizens with cash to strengthen their resilience to Boko Haram manipulations. This also costs money. We are undertaking other social protection interventions which cost money, and yet we are among states that are the most constant in paying monthly salaries and pensions. As we may have seen in some states, downsizing is taking place in order to cope with payment of salaries and pensions of workers. In Borno State, we cannot afford mass retrenchment of workers because we know the potential social implications of such actions. While many persons may argue that workers are in fewer thousands, we recognize that these numbers have multiplying effects, not only in terms of bigger number of dependents, but also on the effect of salaries and pensions in our local economy. Thousands of traders, both small and medium, rely on sales from the funds pumped into the local economy for survival. Therefore, cannot afford a massacre to cope with wages. Rather, we are even employing more and more persons. For instance, we have in January this year employed and trained 800 teachers, just as we employed more doctors, nurses, midwives, and other support staff. To create more rooms for employment, we are reviving industries and putting the good ones to productivity. We are also preparing grounds for our youth to become more employable, and we do this by seasoning awarding scholarships to hundreds for specialized courses abroad and for all programs across Nigeria. We are subsidizing access to education by paying annual scholarship to over 20,000 students in tertiary schools within and outside Borno. We even pay tuition fees for over 3,500 students of our state university. Yet, we have been supporting parents and guardians by paying for their senior secondary school certificate examination fees for our citizens. Borno state government will also look into the possibility of recruiting additional 2,000 teachers this year, inshallah. Fellow citizens, Borno state is shouldering these responsibilities because we recognize that they impact on the generality of our citizens. However, we cannot sustain all these subsidies in primary, secondary, and tertiary education, in health, in consistency of salaries and pensions, and creating new jobs, and giving out start-up capitals to small and medium-scale businesses, business persons, unless we create means of increasing our internally generated revenue through some of the tax measures we took, the blocking of leakages and strengthening of our revenue-generating establishment with bold targets. Borno State Geographic Information System, BOGIS, has in less than 2 years of its existence generated about 1 billion naira, while we were only able to generate around 100 million from 2017 to end of 2019. Of course, affected citizens in few hundreds were happy with not paying land levies in previous years. But then nearly 1 billion naira generated by BOGIS has been used on public services that included subsidizing education and healthcare to benefit the generality of Borno people. The same applies to whatever we generate through other taxes. We are prudently deploying this idea for the benefit of all citizens through the execution of impactful programs and projects. Fellow citizens, given my background, I know the pains of struggle, but I also know that it is better for us to take these sacrifices that will enable government to sustain the subsidies on basic education, secondary and tertiary education, on healthcare and jobs creation, on salaries and pensions, on creating jobs and supporting traders, on supporting displaced persons, and on supporting volunteers and our armed forces in fight against Boko Haram and lots more. As your governor, I assure you that all resources are judiciously put to uses that are either benefiting all citizens or will benefit all citizens in the long run. We are determined to remain on the track of finding enduring peace in Borno State. We are determined to continue our massive construction of thousands of homes for the relentless and safe resettlement of displaced persons and refugees. We have been able to return our citizens from refugee camps in Niger and Cameroon to safe and dignified resettlement in parts of Borno State. We will continue in this regard the same way we will continue in safety resettling IDPs. As we have started our third year in office, we plan to build on what we have already achieved with your support, God will and prayers. We plan to soon commission series of projects, accelerate others, particularly thousands of ongoing houses for safe and dignified resettlement of our IDPs and refugees. Fellow citizens, in Nigeria's democratic journey, the challenges before the Borno State government are enormous. Even as I address you, we are battling with power disruption caused by repeated attacks on power installations supply Maiduguri and other parts of the state. We're working around the clock, relevant authorities to restore power supply, while we are making frantic efforts to actualize an intervention coming from the LNPC, which will hopefully put an end to power disruptions. I kindly call for more patience and tolerance. We are resolutely committed to doing anything lawful and meaningful towards making Borno safer and with greater opportunities for you, the people, as we resiliently march towards our recovery, our growth, our sustained development, and our shared prosperity. Borno is ours, and Borno's success is our success. Happy Democracy Day, and may God bless Borno State and the Federal Republic of Nigeria.